Hello everyone, and welcome to our sixth doctoral seminar for this spring featuring Lindy Johnson. She's a doctoral student at University of Georgia, and she has recently accepted a position as Assistant Professor of English Education at William & Mary. Congratulations to Lindy. This is the first time Lindy is presenting at our doctoral web seminars. We really appreciate that she will be sharing her insights with us tonight. I would like to introduce Dr. Peggy Albers, professor at Language and Literacy. She's the founder of the Conversations in Doctoral Preparation and Global Conversations in Literacy Research. I am one of the moderators tonight, Tuba Angay Crowder, doctoral student in the third year at Language and Literacy, Georgia State University. These are mentoring web seminars that are really designed by doctoral students and for doctoral students. We as doctoral students are delighted to hear each other's perspectives on different topics because we may sometimes have different kinds of ideas on what our professors present. So we are very excited to have doctoral candidates like Lindy, Ryan Borland, who was our first presenter this spring, and Aramin Jihei will be the next presenters. We are excited that they are sharing their insights into different aspects of the doctoral program. We will continue extending our doctoral web seminars to different doctoral students from across the world, across the country, and hopefully these web seminars will extend across the world as we start to establish these particular web seminars. We would love to see this extended into a global conversations around doctoral preparation so that we can learn from and with each other. These doctoral web seminars can be different types. They can be research-based, so we can present our research, or we can present on some aspects of the doctoral program, or in mentoring ourselves into the academy. And tonight's presentation by Lindy, the title of her presentation, Two Birds, One Stone, Strategies for Developing Your Academic Writing, is just one of those mentoring sessions that allow us to write academically and professionally. We like to have this skill while we are in the program and also after our graduation. So I think many of you are familiar with the Blackboard Collaborate tools. Feel free to chat and ask questions to Lindy in the chat area. We will collect those questions. Or you can just raise your hand here like this. We will call upon you. And you can ask Lindy your questions just by speaking into the microphone or computer here. And I know Lindy has already elicited questions on her Facebook page related to this presentation. And I'm guessing that she will address those questions during or after her presentation. So we are really excited about you, having you participate and ask you kind of questions that you have for Lindy as she is presenting. It is really my pleasure to present Lindy Johnson tonight. Lindy is a doctoral student at University of Georgia. Her research interests include critical digital literacies, multimodal composition, and discourse analysis. Her dissertation study examines how teachers learn to incorporate digital tools and writing process pedagogy during a year-long professional development program. Before pursuing her doctorate, she taught high school English in Boston Public Schools. Lindy is the chair of the Conference on English Education Graduate Strand. She has experience in presenting at conferences and organizing the conference, titled Activist Literacies Inspire, Create, Engage, Transform. This was in Athens in 2013. Among her publications are book chapters about critical literacy and multimodal composition, and an article in a journal of English teaching practice and critique. Lindy will share her experience as the principal editor of the Journal of Language and Literacy Education. She has received a grant in the academic year of 2013 and 2014. This is from No Child Left Behind, Title II, Part A, Higher Education, Improving Teacher Quality, Higher Education Grant, in an amount of $38,262 to study Writing 2.0, Pathways to a 21st Century Writing Pedagogy. And I will announce a couple of the awards that Lindy has received. In 2013, she was selected as a Summer Research Fellow for the Digital Media and the Learning Institute, funded by the John and Catherine MacArthur Foundation. And again in 2013, Carolyn Fisher Award for Excellence in Research from the University of Georgia Publications. So it's a great deal pleasure that I introduce Lindy, and she's going to talk about strategies for developing our academic writing. So Lindy, you're on.
All right, great. Thank you for that lovely introduction to you, but that was very kind and generous of you. Before I get started, I just have to give some shout outs to my wonderful committee. You can see them pictured here. Professor Peter Smagorinsky, who is my dissertation advisor, Professor Donna Alverman, Professor Ruth Harmon, and Professor TJ Kopcha. And I just feel very indebted to all of these wonderful professors for being just so generous in their mentoring and really helping me learn how to become a better academic writer. So I wanted to start off with that shout out. I also just want to reiterate that I would love questions as I'm talking. So Peggy and Tuba will interrupt me if you have questions that are related to whatever slide I'm talking about. So to begin, there are some underlying assumptions that I just kind of wanted to go over. And I think, as you can see in this painting here, which is from the 19th century, writing is really difficult, and it has been long before we came along. And so one of the things I think we really have to remember as doctoral students, especially when we're learning, there's such a steep learning curve. And, you know, I think we have to be very patient with ourselves. I know, you know, the type of people who go into doctoral studies tend to be perfectionists and tend to be overachievers. And becoming an academic writer, it really does take a very long time. And so just remembering that, I think, is very important. The other piece that I kind of wanted to reiterate, and this is something that I've come to understand a little bit better over the last couple of years, is that academia is just, it's a big conversation. And you have to make sure that your writing is situated in that conversation. And again, that takes a while. It takes a while to read and to really kind of understand what the field is interested in and what the field and people around you feel like is relevant and important. All right. So, jumping right in. As I was thinking about this presentation and what I could talk about, I was really just thinking about the ways that I tried to be as efficient and productive in my writing as possible. And, you know, as doctoral students, I know that we all have so much on our plates. I mean, you know, we're taking coursework, we're doing conference proposals, some of us are teaching full-time, some of us have research assistants, teaching assistantships. I have children, young children. So there's so much for us to balance. And so it's really important to, from the very beginning, be very mindful and try to be very strategic about how you are approaching your graduate studies. So the first strategy that I really can recommend is to very carefully coordinate your coursework and conference proposals and make sure that those are working in harmony with each other toward publication. So I want to give you an example of this. Donna Alverman, who is on my committee, is a wonderful teacher, and I took a pop culture class from her during my first year as a doctoral student. And one of the things that we had to do in that class was we had to submit our final paper for publication. So I wrote a paper. It was on using pop culture with pre-service English teachers, and I submitted it to a journal, Journal of Adolescent and Adult Literature. And very sadly, the manuscript was rejected. And I was very upset, but Donna said, you know what, that's part of the process. You accept it and you move on. So I took some of those ideas that I had written about in that paper, and I used those ideas to do a proposal for NCTE. So then at NCTE, I presented on some of these ideas. And then almost a year later, there was a call out for book chapters, and so I submitted a proposal that was heavily revised, but it was based on a lot of these ideas that I had in this paper for a book proposal, and I also got two co-authors to work with me on that, and it was published. So, well, it's being published right now, so it's going to come out in May 2014. And so as you can see, that process took 3 years. So I just say that because, you know, the process does take a long time. So you really want to make sure that you start early, and start thinking, you know, your first year, what papers am I writing that I might be able to turn into conference proposals, and then from there, turn those into publications. The second strategy is if you're going to present something at a conference, you should try to publish something from that. And that's a strategy that I didn't totally understand until maybe my third year. I see a question. So can I just take this question, Peggy?
Yes, go ahead, Lindy.
Okay, because I see Rebecca says, the first manuscript was authored by myself. And so how did working with co-authors change it? So it changed dramatically from the first iteration of the article to what got published. But what I ended up doing is I ended up using a lot of the theoretical aspects of my pop culture paper and then combining it with a teacher who's in schools working with kids and using some of the examples from his classroom to kind of illustrate the theory that I was talking about in the first manuscript. So that's how it changed. And part of the problem with the first manuscript was that, and this is what the reviewer said, was that it was too theoretical and conceptual and didn't have enough like actual data and classroom examples to back it up. So that's a great question. Okay. All right, so strategy two, if you present it, publish it. So unfortunately, I haven't always abided by this strategy, but it's very useful because if you think about all of the time that you put into putting together a proposal and writing that proposal and coordinating that proposal and making a Prezi or a PowerPoint for that proposal, in essence, you've done a lot of the heavy lifting for an article, you know what I mean? And you might not be able to necessarily publish it in a research journal, but you could publish something for practitioners or in another kind of journal. So that's something that I kind of finally figured out year three, and I'm really happy I did. It makes sense. Okay. Oh, and Nicole says the feedback given at the presentation can sometimes help you figure out the ways the paper needs to be changed to make it more publishable. Absolutely. That's a great point, Nicole. Thank you for bringing that up. And I have had that happen where people will just bring up perspectives you hadn't thought about, or they'll see kind of holes in your argument that you hadn't hadn't even thought about. So it's a great place to try out your ideas and then refine them.
Say, Lindy, we have a question too. Can you talk a little bit about whether or not you revise a lot based upon that first set of feedback, or do you send it out once or twice without revising heavily, just in case you ended up having some reviewers that might not have understood your work?
Yeah, that's a great point. And I have actually been advised to try to turn it around really quickly in most cases, but in this case, it was kind of too theoretical, and I just didn't have any data to back up the claims that I was trying to make. And so I did kind of put it on hold for a little bit, because I think I was right. I was kind of just waiting for the right person to collaborate with, so where we could try out these ideas related to pop culture and really think through them. So the reviewers just say, you know, you might try submitting this to Journal of Teacher Education or another spot. But I did feel that the paper needed some more evidence to back it up. But that's a great question. So the third strategy is volunteer to review manuscripts. And maybe we can just have, well, I guess I don't know if I can do this, but I'm just curious to know how many people have reviewed manuscripts who are here. You know, is that, are people raising their, oh good, yay! Plus one! That's great, because I think that has been a really important part of helping me to understand what is going on in the field of literacy. You know, it really gives you a sense of what's relevant. It provides insight into the editorial process, and it really shows you that there can be disagreement on whether a piece gets published or not, or whether how much revision they think a piece needs. And it's also so much easier to kind of see the mistakes that other people are making in their writing, and then it just, that really alerts you to, oh gosh, wow, I really need to make sure I have research questions, or I really need a clear introduction, or I need to really, you know, think about how I can craft my abstract so that it makes sense. So I highly recommend reviewing manuscripts. And I know lots of journals are open to having doctoral students serve as reviewers, but two that I've done extensive reviewing for are the Journal of Language and Literacy Education, which is run by doctoral students here at the University of Georgia. We welcome people to come and review for that, and also to submit to that article as well. And then also Contemporary Issues in Technology and Teacher Education welcomes doctoral student reviewers. And so again, it's just a really great opportunity to see what people are submitting, see what's out there, see what gets published, and see what doesn't get published.
Lindy, we have a question from Esmeralda. And she asks, and this is a little bit about your previous slide, and that is, does what you present on need to align with your dissertation?
That's a great question, and I will tell you that it probably, okay, so I'll tell you what my professor said, and then I'll tell you what I did. My professor said that everything should align. But mine didn't always align, and they don't. I mean, you know, in a perfect world, everything would be perfectly aligned and make this nice linear path toward your dissertation. But I have, like most of us, I have a lot of different interests. And so I've published on things that aren't directly related to my dissertation, and I presented on lots of things not directly related to my dissertation. So that's my answer for what it's worth. All right, so the next strategy I wanted to talk a little bit about is organizing your reading. And this is another one that I didn't quite get until maybe my second year. And that is, so, you know, your good writing has to begin with good reading. And you're going to read hundreds and hundreds of articles and books during your doctoral program, and you have to think about how you're going to be able to access all of all of this information that you've read. So you have to develop a system to keep track of everything you've read. And I know that, you know, as someone who has been a lifelong reader and I have a pretty good recall for things I've read, there are articles from 3 years ago, I have, you know, you have no clue. You will not remember anything that you read from 3 years ago unless you have a system where you keep everything organized. So you can use RefWorks, you can use Zotero, EndNote, Mendeley. It doesn't really matter what system you use. They all work pretty similarly, but just make sure that you're consistent about using your system every time you read anything. And you will have an amazing library to draw on when you get to your dissertation. So just to show you kind of what this is a screenshot of my Zotero. I use Zotero. And I really, really like Zotero. It's very easy to use. It's free. You can just, you download it. It is compatible with Mozilla Firefox, and it's a little add-on that you can just, you add onto your browser. And so I use Google Scholar a lot. So you can just, it's very easy to search for something in Google Scholar, and then you can just automatically save it to your Zotero library. And then as you can see on the left, I have all these different folders of all the different things I'm interested in. And then you have the author, the title. And then in this section on the right-hand side, you'll see the bibliographic information. And in that area, you can do notes and tags and things like that, but I actually annotate all of my articles in a separate Word document.
Lindy, we have a couple of questions for you on this.
Sure.
And the first question, Rebecca asked, how often do you annotate? You just mentioned that you annotate your resources. Do you annotate them after every article, or do you wait till the end of the semester? Do you group them Could you talk a little bit about that? And then the second question about Zotero, I think, is asked by Esmeralda, and she asks, could you just talk a little bit about Zotero? Not everybody knows what that is.
Sure.
So could you talk about that just a little bit?
Yeah. Sure. So Zotero is just a bibliographic online platform that's free. And what Zotero does is it is a way to organize all of the articles that you come across in your reading. And then it keeps them in folders for you. And then it also generates bibliographic information in APA or MLA or whatever style you want to use. APA 6. You know, we all use APA 6. So it will annotate, it will create a little bibliographic information for you. And it does things similar to like RefWorks or EndNote if you use those through your library. It's a similar type of thing. And in terms of how I use it, I annotate my articles right after I read them, because if I waited until the end of the semester to annotate, I wouldn't remember what the article said. And so I annotate as I'm reading. And I think that that's really important. That's been very important for me. And I can show you, I'm going to talk a little bit about this, which was strategy number 5, and that's keep scholarly notes or annotations, annotated bibliography. At the University of Georgia, they call them scholarly notes. So you should never read anything without taking notes on it. And that's something that I don't think I learned until maybe my second year, because I thought I would remember the articles that I was reading, but you won't. So you have to keep your scholarly notes or annotated bibliography. So during my coursework, I would keep a separate Word document for each of my classes, and some of my classes actually required it, and I think it's a great idea if professors do require it, because I think it just helped me so much to stay on top of my reading and writing, and it's really been the most important thing I've done as a writer. So scholarly notes are the place to practice your summarizing and paraphrasing skills, but it's also that time to begin making connections between readings and to keep track of your analytic thinking as you read. And so it's what scholarly notes are, your annotations are, they are pre-writing. You know, you're starting to sort through all of this material. And so I wanted to show you an example from my annotated bibliography. So this is an entry from a class I took on multimodality. We had to have an annotated bibliography, and we had to create an annotation for every chapter or article that we read. So here, this is from Carrie Jewett's, the introduction to her book, The Routledge Handbook of Multimodal Analysis. And so what you'll see is I have that in AP format at the top. Then I have a summary of my own summary of Jewett's work in my own words. And I can, again, but that's something that I've gone back and drawn on through a lot of different articles I've written. So I have my summary. Then I have key terms. So like mode, semiotic resource, I'm defining these as Jewett's defining them. And then I also have my own thoughts, like what am I actually thinking about this particular chapter, what's it connecting to? And so that's an example of my annotated bibliography. And so we had, I think, 50 or 60 entries for this multimodality class. It was quite a lot of writing, but what it enabled me to do later on was to come back and draw on all of these annotations that I have made. And it just became so much easier when I've had to do like lit reviews and write proposals and so on. So that's an example from my annotated bibliography. Now, it's very easy to skip this part if your professors don't require it, and to say, oh, I'll do it later. You won't. You won't do it later. You have to do it while you're reading. And it does feel so time consuming. But you really have to do the work up front, and you will thank yourself later at the end of your doctoral program when you have, you know, you've been able to do 4 or 5 publications because you've organized your reading and writing and thinking in this way. Okay. Before I move on, are there any other questions about annotations or anything like that?
Yeah, Lindy, we have Esmeralda who's asking, how do these notes support your work later?
Right. Great question, Esmeralda. So, as an example, I am talking a little bit about, well, not a little bit, I'm talking quite a bit about multimodality in my dissertation research. And in my dissertation research, my dissertation is actually structured as 3 articles because we're allowed to write 3 articles. For our dissertation as an option. And so in each of my articles, I have to write a theoretical framework. And a lot of my theoretical framework draws on social semiotic theories of multimodality. So I have been able to come back to these annotations and very easily, well, fairly easily, put all of these ideas together and write, you know, a 10-page theoretical framework in not that much time. And I don't have to go back and reread all of the stuff, you know, all of the 60 articles that I've read on multimodality. So hopefully that makes sense. All right. So my next strategy is to develop the habit of writing every single day. So maybe let's get a raise of hands for how many people write every single day. Or clapping, or plus one.
Yay, we have a yes, no poll right there. Right next to the little hand, there's a little drop-down menu. So if people just want to go ahead and do the little yes, no, that'd be
yes,
great.
No.
And we can find
out
what it is.
Okay, great. Thanks. That's fun.
And Lindy, I don't know, Lindy, I know you're going to talk about strategy 6, but Chris actually had a question about Zotero again. Can we backtrack just a tad?
Let's do it.
Yeah, Chris asks, do you keep notes attached to the articles, or do you keep them organized by theme? That's a terrific question.
Yeah, I have them organized by themes. So what I did, like when I started out, I had all of my multimodality notes in one place. Anything having to do with multimodality. And then I kind of keep them related to, I would say by theme. So right now I'm doing one of my articles is about design-based research. And so I have an annotated bibliography that's just dedicated to design-based research. So if you were to look at my library, these folders, I kind of have my annotated bibliographies organized similar to what are in these folders, the yellow folders. So that's just my system, and that is what works for me. And it just, I like having it organized by theme because I will go back to my annotations and I'll go, like with my design-based research article, I'll go back and read through my annotations and I'll kind of be able to draw themes out again that I may have missed. So I like having them organized by themes. That works for me. All right. So we'll go to developing the habit of writing every single day. It looks like we have 5 yeses, 5 noes. Maybe some people didn't vote. But this has been a little bit, this looks like it got cut off, but it's really, really important to set aside a chunk of time to write every single day. And you have to schedule it in your calendar. And I have scheduled, usually it's 9 to 11 a.m. is my writing time. And I know that that's hard for people who work, but one of the things that I've done is I set a timer for writing time for 45 minutes. And during that 45 minutes, I listen to Pandora, I listen to music, and I don't allow myself to check my email or Facebook or my phone or Twitter or get out of my seat. I just force myself to write for 45 minutes. The timer goes off. I use online stopwatch. And the timer goes off. And then when the timer goes off, I get to take a 15-minute break. And I get to check my email and get a drink of water, walk around. And it is really hard, but I have had, again, like in terms of being efficient, that's been really, really important for me, is to be hyper-focused during that 45 minutes, because when you're writing and you don't have, you know, a strict deadline, it's so easy to just kind of surf around on the internet or check your Twitter feed multiple times. So you've got to write every day, and you've got to be really consistent and focused about it. And as I've done this, I know that some days my writing is going to go really well, and I'll have all these great insights, and I'll think, wow, this is just, the words are flowing, and it's a beautiful thing. And some days, you know, it feels like torture, and it seems like everything you write is like embarrassingly bad, but you just know that that's part of the writing process. And I've read enough about writers and how they write to know that you have good days and bad days, and you still just keep going, you keep practicing, because it is a habit, and you do have to develop that habit.
Lindy? We have a question from Nigel, and Nigel asks, any recommendation for writing groups and their structures?
Oh, that's a great question. I haven't done writing groups per se, but I have written collaboratively with people. I don't have a ton of recommendations for writing groups, but I will say that I enjoy writing collaboratively with people. That's been really helpful to me. And I also know there's a great website that actually helps organize people into writing groups. And I think it's called, I can't remember the name of it, maybe it's like Academic Writer. Gina Hyatt is the person who runs it. And she helps people kind of check in with each other and be accountable to each other, which I think can be really, really helpful. That probably isn't the best. Sorry, Nigel, that's not like the best answer. I know Nigel. But, you know, I think I do know people who have done that, and I think that can be really helpful. One thing I will say about writing groups, I guess, the way that I've kind of approached it is I've continued to take coursework throughout my doctoral career. So even though I'm going to be graduating soon, I'm still taking courses. I'm taking a qualitative analysis course. So a lot of that you know, I do a lot of writing with people and have other people read my work in within the structure of those doctoral courses. And I know not everyone can do that, but that's worked for me. Yes.
Sorry about that. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, please.
Tanya and Sean have questions for you. Tanya asks,
okay,
how do you organize or plan what to write about? And Chong asks, will you share with us what you usually write about?
Oh, sure. So how do I organize or plan what to write daily? So, well, during my first 2 years when I was really focused on coursework, I would use my writing time to do my annotations. So I would read my articles and write my annotations. Once I was done primarily with coursework, then I use my writing time to work on my comprehensive examinations. And those were like very long literature reviews. And our comprehensive examinations are take-home exams. We have several months actually to write them. They're about 60 pages long. And so in my third year, about 5 months of my life was dedicated to writing those comprehensive examinations. And so again, I would spend time annotating and writing. So that's kind of how I organized my day and how I planned what to write daily. And so now that I'm working on my dissertation, I have kind of like little mini writing goals that I make for myself every day. So right now my goal is just to finish article number 2, and I know that that's going to take me a couple weeks. And so that's kind of what's on the docket for that particular day. So it really depends on where you are in your coursework and what articles you're working on towards publication in terms of what to write daily.
Could I ask a question? Do you know approximately, most doctoral students want to know about how many articles should they have?
Oh, sure.
Before they actually start applying for positions. Now, you applied to the University of William & Mary, have a job there, but how many publications did you have?
Right, so I have about 5 publications, and then I have some that are under review, and I was told by faculty at our university that if you're going out on the job market and you want to teach at a university, you should have at least 3 publications when you're applying for a job. So that's what they said that they expect.
The follow-up question is, are they all in peer-reviewed journals? Or are they chapters? What were your publications?
There's a mixture. Sure, there's a mixture. Some of them are single authors. Some of them are co-authored with colleagues of mine. 2 of them are co-authored with my major advisor. So my major advisor does write with his students, and that's been a huge help to me. We wrote together during my first and second year as a doctoral student. So I have a mix. I have a couple of peer-reviewed articles, and then I have two book chapters. So it's a mix of things. Based on what I can tell, I think that search committees are most interested in seeing that you are in the habit of publishing things. They're less concerned about, you know, do they have X number of book chapters or X number of peer-reviewed articles? I mean, you know, we are doctoral students, so I don't think they're expecting to see like 10 peer-reviewed articles. But from what I've gathered, they just want to see that there's a pattern of that you've been publishing, you know, that you put your work out there and that you've got a few publications under your belt. Does that help? Is that good, Peggy?
Yes, that's great, Lindy. Thanks very much. You can move on.
Okay,
I think
great.
We answered all of our writing questions. Thanks.
Sure. I don't know if I answered Chong's question about what do I usually write about. I'm writing my dissertation, and it's about a study of how teachers learn to use digital tools in their teaching of writing. All right, so strategy number 7, write with others. So see if your advisor is open to co-authoring. Not all advisors are. I think it just kind of depends who your advisor is. Luckily, Peter Smagorinsky writes with his students all the time and is very generous about co-authoring with them. I'm second author with Peter on his studies, but that's a really valuable opportunity to sit and write with somebody who really knows what they're doing. I've also written a couple of pieces with friends of mine, you know, in my doctoral program. So the people that I really enjoy working with and love to write with. And so that's been a fabulous opportunity to collaborate with people on shared mutual interests. It is important to negotiate the order of authorship before the writing begins. So how we usually do it at Georgia is whoever writes the first draft gets to be first author. And that can be tricky and you have to negotiate it, but as long as you just, you know, set that all up at the beginning, then, you know, you're going to probably avoid hurt feelings or people feeling like they did a lot of work, and so on. So that's what's worked for me in terms of writing with others. Another tip, and this is a great one that somebody shared on Facebook, and I do it, and I think I could be even better about it, but that's this idea of finding writing mentors. So there are people whose work, for example, I love, and I kind of can't get enough of, Glenda Hull, who she's just a fabulous writer. I love her work. It's very, it's been very influential on my work. And so I try to read everything that Glenda's ever written and try to really study what it is about her work that seems to speak to me as a writer. Viv Ellis is another writer and researcher who I really admire, and Kathy Mills' writing is just really clear, and she takes really complicated concepts and puts them in language that people can understand. And so some people were asking about, like, how do you develop your voice in academic writing? And I think that really spending time with your writing mentors, with the writing of your writing mentors, can really help you start to develop the academic voice. I know that it takes a really long time. I don't think that I have necessarily fully gotten there in my own writing, but I'm on my way, so. My strategy number 9 is to embrace rejection. And that's really important, and that's really hard, right? Because again, the type of people who go into doctoral studies are people who are overachievers and who have always gotten A's on all of their assignments. But one of the things that Donna Alverman told me early on in my doctoral studies was that every manuscript has a home. So if you have a manuscript and you've written something and you believe in it, you might have to revise it, but eventually you will find a place for it. And it really is about finding the right fit. The article that I wrote, the pop culture article that got rejected, part of the reason it was rejected was it didn't have a lot of data, but the other part was that it wasn't really geared towards practicing high school teachers, and that's a lot of the audience of JAAL. So, you know, it just wasn't the right fit. And so this is an email from one of my reviewers about that pop culture paper. You know, that the paper is clearly written and well organized, but they say that, you know, the author doesn't convince me that she's contributing anything new to the field. Critical media literacy is now an established area of study, and pop culture a part of most pre-service literacy courses. And so that was kind of hard to hear my first year, you know, that you're not contributing anything new to the field. But now that I read that, I think, well, of course not. I was a first year doctoral student. Usually a first year doctoral student hasn't read enough to contribute something totally new to the field. And so I'm looking at Esmeralda's question, which is a great question. She asks, does everything we write need to be new to the field? Can we be adding or showing a new perspective? Yes, of course. We're going to be, that is the idea, is that you're going to be adding a new perspective. But I don't think I did that either. And it's hard to add a new perspective if you haven't read widely in the field. So my last strategy, number 10, is just to pay it forward. So just to be sure to be generous when you're citing others' ideas. And if somebody has really inspired you to reach out to them and thank them for inspiring you and let them know that you've read their work, and people love to hear that. And I've reached out to a couple people and they've been very happy to have, you know, to know that somebody's reading their work. Be willing to give feedback to others on their writing. And then just be supportive and encouraging in your reviews. One of the things I read that was really interesting was that doctoral student reviewers tend to be the harshest reviewers out there. So we need to just, and part of that I think is maybe like a little bit of insecurity. You know, we kind of overcompensate and we want to let people know that we're not soft and we know what we're talking about. But there's ways to approach reviews and feedback in a way that's really supportive and encouraging while still saying, you know, I really think these particular aspects of the manuscript need more work. So those are my 10 strategies. So I'll take a couple of questions now, I think, if we have any time.
Yeah, we actually do have time, and we have some people who have asked questions a little earlier, and we never got to those, Lindy, but these are questions. Someone asked, do you use a computer-assisted qualitative tool like Deduce or Invivo to write your literature reviews?
I did not. I really wanted to use Invivo to write my literature review. I was so excited about it, but I realized it was going to take me a few months to learn how to do it, and I didn't have a few months. So I just did it by hand. I created big tables in Word and just did it by hand. But I think it's a great idea if you start early enough. And I will say I'm using Invivo now for my my dissertation research, and I really do like it.
Thank you. And one asks, could you organize the articles by the courses that you've taken? And I think that referred to the Zotero strategy.
Yeah, definitely. You could definitely organize them by courses you've taken. I didn't start using Zotero until almost end of my second year. So a lot of my Zotero library is based on work for my dissertation. But yeah, you could definitely use it. That would make sense to organize it according to your courses and then build your folders, you know, based on themes in your dissertation research or whatever. It's a very flexible tool.
This is a really, I think I really like this question. It, because I think it really speaks to how do you organize your life and family as a doc student. Tuba asks, do you have people from your own family who work in the field of education? I ask this because I wonder if you've received support in the family as well.
Yes, actually, my husband is an academic, and he's an English professor, and I've gotten a huge amount of support from him, definitely. That's a great question. I mean, he has a very flexible schedule, so that really works well with our children. We kind of tag team and trade off days. But he's also very understanding that, you know, sometimes I need to leave the house and go write for 4 hours. And he understands that it takes a long time to write a dissertation. And it's not something you can just do in a couple of hours.
That's great. Tanya asks, how long did it take for you to decide on your research focus? Did it take long to find your passion?
It took, you know, I was excited about so many things. I think that's pretty common with doctoral students that I wanted to study everything and I couldn't, it was very hard for me to just focus on one thing. That was definitely hard. And I think I got some good advice from Bob Fecho at Georgia, and he said, you know, don't even think about narrowing your research focus down until the end of your second year. And so I really tried to heed that advice and tried to keep a really open mind. And then my third year was really all about narrowing it. I knew I was interested in technology. I knew I was interested in teachers, but those are two very broad fields. And so my third year was really, really about narrowing it down. And that was really hard. That was really hard. And I needed, took a lot of talking with my advisors and my committee to figure out what exactly I wanted to focus on.
This one has to do with your publications, Lindy. Tuba asks, at what year were you when you had your first publication with your doctoral program?
Yeah, I think it was the end of my second year and my first publication.
Okay,
but it took me a couple years, you know. But I know people who get publications in their first year, so it just kind of depends. But definitely I think it's great to start early.
Yeah, it's really amazing. Chong writes, or asks, did you state a research gap in the paper that you got rejected? And I also wonder if it's really critical to include it to get published in general.
I did. I alluded to a research gap. I don't think it was very well articulated. I think it is important. Yeah, I think it is very important to get, in most cases, again, it depends on the journal. I wrote one piece that was much more of a narrative inquiry piece, and it had nothing about a gap in the research. So it really does depend on the journal that you're writing for, and if you're writing a strictly kind of research empirical piece, or if you're writing for teachers, depends on your audience.
I think we have. I have a last question for you. I think most people have written their questions. So, Lindy, now that you have a job,
yes.
What do you think? One of your first. What do you think some of your first ideas will be when you start working with doctoral students at William and Mary? How will you start to work with them?
Well, you know, I think it'll probably be very similar to the ways in which. I worked with my advisor, Peter Smagorinsky, and that is that it was very collaborative. He brought me in on a research in a research apprenticeship in which I worked really closely with him on a research project. I transcribed interviews and coded these interviews with him. So really working very collaboratively with a doctoral student, bringing him right into the research process is something that I plan to do.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful. Thank you very much. I think that's going to conclude our seminar. Tuba has a couple of closing slides, and then we will thank all of you for coming. So Tuba, you're on now.
Okay. What I'd like to say is thank you to Lindy. We can still write something in the chat area, some comments that you learned or that you would like to say, Lindy, about her presentation. We always like to hear feedback. I really want to thank Lindy. Her insights into developing our academic writing are very keen. And being a published author and the editor of a journal, she offered some wonderful tips and advice on how to develop our academic writing. So I really appreciate that. Lindy, thank you very much. We really appreciate you speaking with us tonight. I also would like to have you, if you haven't, I'd like you to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter with the hashtag doctoral_prep. If you go to the Conversations and Doctoral Preparations website in the Facebook area, you will be able to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. And please share this information with your colleagues. I also want to alert you to the upcoming web seminars for the spring. We have Aram Choi and Jihei Shin from Georgia State University who will talk about the IRB process. They will present on the March 27th. We have Ms. Anne Mary Jackson and Ms. Cassandra Matthews who are presenting on April 3rd, and they will be talking about the PhD journey. And Ms. Daniel Hilaski will be talking about working smarter and not harder, and she's scheduled for April 17. So I really hope that you will put these dates on your calendar, and if you can spread the word, that would be great. And if you can invite people to present with you, perhaps you have friends from another university or you have colleagues from different parts of the world, you may... want to present with you, that would be even more spectacular. We also would like to announce the important dates from Global Conversations and Literacy Research Series. We have the upcoming seminar from Dr. Catherine Beavis from the Griffith College. She's presenting this Sunday on March 16 about living in a digital world, literacy learning, and video games. And we all know Dr. Brian Street in our language and literacy program. I am honored to be the moderator at his presentation on April 27th. Please put these days on your calendar. Thanks for you all coming here tonight. We really appreciate it. Thank you very much. And looking forward to seeing you in class or at campus or on and offline spaces. Good night, and thank you very much.